so sweet. I do remember seeing your the show, right? You were saying that on the show, right?
I sang that on the Jerry Lewis telephone.
Sorry, let me find where my sound has disappeared to. So hold on 1 second.
Okay.
Here we no, that's not it. This is it. Stop. That's good, because you want to hear my piano lesson. Okay, and now I am with everybody, and we heard the song. And ladies and gentlemen, my guest is Dianne Steinberg Lewis. And I don't even know where to start, because this woman has, wow, it's just like, it's a huge, huge life that you have lived and are living, and filled with lots of incredible stuff.
There's a lot of legacy. There's a lot of things that I've done, a lot of things that I didn't like that I did. You know, never satisfied. I mean, I was just listening to that and going, I don't sing like that anymore. I mean, I make jokes all the time. I go, and especially, you know, I had a head cold yesterday, and I'll tell everybody the remedy if they want to know how to talk. But my God, I mean, you know, things drop when you get older, and all of a sudden I'm, Smoky Topaz or something like oh my God, I love him so, and that's so far from EBM. I figured I would criticize first. Okay, so anyway.
Well, that reminds me of when I heard the newer orchestra version of Joni Mitchell. And no, the person who played it for me didn't tell me who it was. And I was like, who's the older black woman, you know? And it was Joni Mitchell.
So she's really sounded good then, huh?
So different, right?
Things you know, change, ladies and gentlemen. You just
yes, they do.
Go with the flow.
Yeah.
Long hair, short hair, dark hair, gray hair. Hey, so we're the new divas. Hello. So anyway.
Well, right. Like I said, I'm not even sure where to start, but there's so much to talk about. It doesn't even matter because we can start anywhere.
Well, you know what? I'm going to start with gratitude, which is what you have on your bulletin board back there. And I'm just grateful that I've come from Memphis, Tennessee, and I'd like to do my shout outs to Kayla and Cody, and they're getting married this weekend. I was supposed to be there and we can't go. But so that would be Kayla Steinberg and Cody Gadd. And you know, they work at FedEx, so they're handling your stuff real well. They need a raise, FedEx. Are you listening? Anyway, I'm just grateful to come from and be a part of such history-making time, although I wasn't there when a lot of things got started in the music that we love, you know, jazz and rock and roll and all that. But my grandfather was there. He was a young 20-some-year-old playing down on Beale Street. Milton Gus Steinberg, you know what I mean? Okay. His father wanted to take him and raise him as a Jew. He was illegitimate, but he wanted to be with his mother down there on Beale Street. And his mother's father was from Germany. But so, you know, these were times, and hey, these times are still going on today. So we take what we have, and we move on. Yeah. And he wanted to be with his mama, and he went down there on Beale Street and worked at Pong's Laundry. And then there was W.C. Handy's stuff over here. And W.C. Handy used to come into town when he was like 21 years old, I think it was. And he was playing at a Pee Wee's Saloon. And here's another thing, talking about immigrants. We just have to be grateful for the richness that our country has in, even though reluctantly, had immigrants coming here. It is what it is because of that.
Probably
none of us would be here if our great-grands didn't come over here.
I know, we're all immigrants.
Whatever they were doing, American running away, maybe. Running away to, or taking a stand, or whatever it was. But so My grandfather was playing at Pee Wee's Saloon, and he was an Italian immigrant that jumped off he was a hobo coming across, and jumped off the train and was cleaning up in the Mississippi River. And somebody, one of the black dudes from what I get from W.C. Handy's book. Now, I'm telling you this too, from things that I put together, from what I've been told and what I read. So, he went down there and he had an accent and they didn't care. And he took him up to Beale Street and he gambled his way up to a fruit basket and a fruit stand and a new suit and a saloon. And then he brought his family from Italy. You know how that goes. You know, you bring the family and that's set up. So, excuse me. So my grandfather started playing piano during the ragtime, and W.C. Handy came in and saw him. And so he went on a short tour, with W.C. Handy. In the meantime, when he did meet my grandmother, she already had 5 children. And so he proceeded to have 10 more kids with her. And most of them ended up musicians.
Oh, wow.
Crying.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, so And being there during ragtime on Beale Street, and then all the other music that happened in the alleyways with the handmade guitars and all that, you know, W.C. Handy, being a musicologist, was able to notate and write down what they were playing. And as you know, W.C. Handy wrote Memphis Blues, St. Louis Blues, and all of that. So he was very influenced from what he heard and saw in Memphis, and to a great extent helped save and notate. I don't know if any of those guys got any writers or publishing, but
probably not, but you know, okay.
So, you know, I got sticklers about that, but we can talk about that later. Yeah, but anyway, yeah. so when my father and his brothers were coming up, I mean, big band jazz was in. They were all in middle school, grade school, high school. Yeah. And my father was a trumpeter. Uh-huh. And he became one of the top trumpeters and orchestra leaders in Memphis, Tennessee. He was like Memphis, when you talk about the tri-state, you're talking about all those southern, I think it was Memphis, my husband needs to be in here now, Memphis, Arkansas, I would think Mississippi, which is more Delta, but it was a tri-state territory. Yeah. That anytime Cab Calloway or Duke Ellington or Hampton would come in town, they would pick up, you know, do their pickup musicians. And my dad's band was the one that they called because that's where all the good musicians were playing.
Yeah.
So so he would usually end up playing first trumpet with them when they came in town.
Okay.
And then as he got older and, you know, fell in love with my mother, and who was homecoming queen at St. Augustine High School, he had his band. It was rare to go. He let her sing with him. You know, her big song was "Whatever Lola Wants." You know, he always said she couldn't sing. You know, but he let her sing because she was pretty. And
can I interrupt? So she was the queen bee, which we'll hear about. But was she black? Because it said something like the first black, but she didn't really look black. So I just wondered.
Well, gee, look at me, you know. So,
yeah.
So it's not an uncommon thing, I think, you know, be people being all mixed up and everything. And
yeah.
You all look, you know. Yeah.
But she was considered,
well, you know what the United States says, one drop and you're considered. Yeah. Black, as they call it in the days, colored, you know. And so, okay. But when she was 10 years old, she was queen of, it was a carnival. I would call it the Cotton Carnival, but it was another name. So that was the first time she was queen. And then she became the homecoming queen in her senior year. And then she wanted to be a nurse, but my father, he just wanted her so that, oh my God. So anyway, and he hooked up. And I meant to tell you something about when she would sit in with his band. She would sing Whatever Lola Wants, and then she would do the cha-cha, you know, because in the 50s, you know how Cuba was very, you know, all that Latin stuff. And
yeah.
Of course we got, Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz, you know, that came later, but all building up to that time, the Cuban and Afro-Cuban things, America was just loving it.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of wondering, do you remember when the Bossa Novas came out?
I do. I was very young. It was probably
late 40s?
Early 60s. Oh, Bossa Nova. I don't know. I was going to say, okay, well, I remember learning Jobim music, and that was kind of all those songs like Girl from Ipanema and One Note Samba. Those were very popular when I was probably like 5, so late 50s. That's what I remember.
About popular.
Yeah, but well,
that sounds about right.
Yeah.
What is that song? What is that?
How Insensitive.
I just love that. Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
We must get together. and sing some songs again. So anyway, and one night, you know, a keyboard player couldn't show up. And so my dad threw my Aunt Gladys on the piano. He taught everybody in the family how to play. Everybody, my grandfather, because he was working down at the Peabody Hotel down there, you know, where the ducks go to the fountain and all that. And he had played with W.C. Handy. He always continued to play piano, and he played by ear. Uh-huh. So he had a piano in the house, and everybody learned it. Until Ancestry.com came along, we didn't know anything about my grandma Ida Fox's family. We're not going to know anything. We're not going to know who grandpa's dad is. And I mean, we're still like in limbo with a lot of that, but we're finding out a lot now about my grandmother. And it appears that she played piano too. And I just recently found out because we have relatives in Boca Raton.
Wow.
Yeah, you know, so, you know, and I had no idea. So we've been able to fill in blanks about the family, and the discovery is still going on. And I just like doing it. To me, it's kind of like, I had a cousin say, why are you still going in the past and doing all that? what is the problem?
Why not?
God, I mean, I think it's fascinating.
Yeah.
And of course, one of my favorite shows is Lewis, you know, the Roots thing with Henry Louis Gates. Yeah, I'd love to talk to him because he probably can fill in a lot of things. But in the meantime, would you like a drink?
Thank you. I have my vocal zone.
Okay. I think my husband put something in this because I'm acting silly already. Okay. So, okay. So I got the sniffles and you got the cough. All right. So, with the music part of it all the brothers and the sisters were given the opportunity to play piano. And my Aunt Nan, was the first one to leave Memphis, and she sang with Bunny Berrigan, and she went out on the road. She might have been maybe about 19 years old or something when she went out. I have to ask, but she went out with several, you know, orchestras that had trumpet players as the leader, and then she had a time with Fats Waller. We can't find any pictures, but of her singing with Fats Waller, but she ended up marrying, this is Dan Steinberg, she ended up marrying a guy later on after her first marriage who was a hoofer at the Cotton Club.
Oh, wow.
And so my cousin has a book that we finally got back from the African-American Charles Wright Museum in Detroit. When she was in high school, my cousin got one of those, you know, those books you go to Home Depot to look at wallpaper, and they're huge and you just, you know, turn them.
Yeah.
So she had so many pictures that she began to take pictures and put them in this book. And there were people like Duke Ellington and Count Basie in that book. Wow. And the original dancers from Cotton Club and Dorothy Dandridge. And I mean, and so when the Detroit Museum said it, they said, this book is more comprehensive than what we had going out on the traveling tour. Cause you know, they take exhibits and they get them go. So we are going to, or my cousin Miltonette said that she was going to bequeath it to the museum, you know, because they take such great care of it. And there are historical people in the book. Who was the boxer of Sugar Ray Robinson? Was it Sugar?
Yeah, I think
the Brown Bomber.
Sorry?
Who was the Brown Bomber?
That I don't know. Was it Charlie Robinson?
Kenny. Okay, so the pictures that we've got. What's his name? That was with Jack Benny. The one that said, "Yeah, Mr. Benny." What's his name?
I forget his name.
Oh,
my husband knows, but I don't know.
Yeah, we should call our husbands in here now. Sit over there and be a reference. But there are amazing pictures of the artists who were at the Cotton Club. So my aunt, she toured for a while, but then after she married Eddie, she didn't sing anymore.
Yeah.
She played piano and sang. And then my dad had his orchestra, and he had like a jazz great Phineas Newborn Jr. We called him Finus. He was a child prodigy, and he was a little younger than my dad, but he was in the band. And so the Newborn family had a band, like the Steinberg family had a band, like the Wynton Marcellus family has a band.
Yeah.
And so knowing everybody and knowing all those dynamics and things that happened to them and with them over the years. And what's really wonderful is my dad used to tease me. He'd go, you know, Finus played the Rhapsody in Blue when he was 14. I'm crying, you know. But, and I go, I get all huffy, like, you know, well, I'm okay. I'm going to play it too. It make me jealous, you know, of this genius, right? And was that child abuse? No. but it just got me excited. So when I turned 9 years old, he bought me my first easy copy of Rhapsody in Blue. And I'll never forget, we were in the driveway at home on Trigg Street. I mean, I'm starting to remember the streets we lived on. And it was my birthday, and he walked up. And this, I think my mom and him had been separated. They got separated all the time. But anyway, this is one day that he came. And he presented it to me, and it was like having somebody open up a box of jewels or something, and I was like, so I was determined that I was going to play Rhapsody in Blue. And so it was an easy one. And then he'd get me the intermediate one. And then it kept going until I was in high school. And I had to, you know, I always kept up with my piano. And so when I got to Detroit, we'd moved from Memphis in 63 going into 64 to Detroit, Michigan. And so my mother got me a piano teacher. And he knew that I had played a little of the Rhapsody in Blue. And he said, well, let's get you ready. So we did he gave me the real version, but this was a duet with me and him playing the other orchestral parts on the organ.
Yeah.
And then after that, he said, I think you're ready. So then he gave me the real deal. And I learned that thing, and I was, and then I got boy crazy. I won't even tell you the guy's name.
Oh, yeah, man. That always
gets and then, and then they said, well, you know, you're going to play with the Detroit Symphony. Ooh. And my mom said, when are you going to start rehearsing? I was, I don't know, 15, 16, oh boy. So anyway, I'm looking at your board back there, and it says, be brave. So, I've decided after that and the records I've had, because I was with ABC and Atlantic Records, ABC, then I did Sgt. Pepper and then recorded on RSO. And then I did a gospel album after my first born in 1987. And it was on commission for my mother. Excuse me, I need to just lighten up here a little bit. And then to then start performing again when, you know, I went back to teaching because after I graduated from Western Michigan University with public school music, major keyboard and theory and composition minor, I taught at Battle Creek Central and it was choir and some music theory and then I got a choir. There were these, I was accompanying for Giff Richards, who had worked with Norman Luboff. And you know, that choir was like, anytime they'd be on TV, you know, it's like, oh, Norman Luboff. So Giff Richards, who was a master, and I'd like to shout out to everybody at Battle Creek. I love you. I miss all of you. Aww. Now, you know, but especially Kurt, because he's the one that takes all those pictures. But I would accompany for the a cappella choir, and we went to Romania for 3 weeks and, you know, did all that. And then after that, I got my first audition with ABC Records.
Yeah.
So, you know, things keep going along. And then after all those years, I went back to teaching. When I came up here to San Luis Obispo and my kids were growing up, I went, I can't be touring and doing, all, you know, I've just seen kids, you know, and their parents aren't there. And Kenny is in the Steve Miller Band. So he was gone a lot. So somebody had to be home. So it was okay because I got to do West Side Story with the high school, choreographing that. And then, you know, then I, well, let me back up. I learned the Rhapsody in Blue, but then I did West Side Story in high school. Then I did it after I finished college. And then I choreographed it for the high school in Battle Creek. And then my daughter, when we came to San Luis Obispo, they did West Side Story in San Luis Obispo High School. And I accompanied and helped with the music on that. So, I mean, I played in the pit. I've done everything on that song.
And you're playing piano, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And let me ask you something. This is just kind of, it's in what you're talking about, but it's kind of off to the side. Yeah. So I think because I've been thinking about satisfaction, you know, and satisfaction as a kind of a success, you know, like, you know, what is success, you know, and I think it's satisfaction, you know. And I'm just wondering, you know, you've had a lot of different things in your life. And do you find that certain particular things have given you satisfaction as opposed to other things which one would imagine would give you satisfaction but didn't?
Wow. To me, it's not enough to just be on stage.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, think about it. I'm going to go theatrically. You know, they always talk about postpartum. Post-production depression. You know, it's like the project's done.
Yeah.
And you're going, ugh.
After you're depressed.
All that applause. You know, it's like we love applause. But I think the one thing that I got from my mother and seeing, you know, my dad was supposed to be what Elvis Presley became.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You know, Sam Phillips was his manager. And this was right when Boogie Woogie was coming in. And you know, a lot of jazz guys, do they really like playing rock and roll? It's not a rhetorical question, but okay, I'll just put it in.
I know, I'm kind of waiting.
Maybe we should call up someone. Hey, Dave. Okay. So, I mean, the younger jazz musicians, they know how to play it. But dyed-in-the-wool jazz guys don't generally. I'll tell you, when you got a good song and a good melody, they will leech that out no matter what that sucker sounds like, you know? And they'll do something with it. And it's like, whoa, I didn't know you could do that with that. You know, so music is music. But I think that our generation is a little bit more open-minded, maybe, than the old bebop guys.
You know? I think so too.
Yeah. So and also, I found that people who play classical piano, I've had some professors come to me and say, "I can't do what you do." And as I'm going, ice cream changes da 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 da. To me, it's I don't. I'm very grateful that I had a babysitter that taught me that, because her dad was a minister and they had a broke down piano, you know, and she'd babysit us and I'd play that stuff. But you know, I and do variations on it. But I, you know, my dad would say, "I'm sorry, I didn't teach you jazz." And I'd go, "Hey, you know, come on." And I know you're gonna agree. I love jazz. I love it. But you know, instrumental all night long, they go, "Come on, where's the girl singer? I want you." I shouldn't have said that, huh?
It definitely happens. Yeah.
You know, it's either the girl singer, or you better bring out the dancing bear or something, you know. or the top guy. Guys, you know I'm kidding. You know. I don't know.
No, but it's realistic. Me. It's like, you know, you have to have some kind of interest in the music. My husband's actually not a big jazz guy. He likes rock and blues better. He has thousands of records, and that's what he liked, you know. And I introduced him to more and more jazz stuff, and I know what he will like, but he doesn't like kind of the typical sit, you know, like the straight ahead stuff that he has to follow deeply, because that's not where his awareness is.
Right. Yeah, so. And, you know, I can go so far with it and I go, wow, it's like so far above my head. Yeah. It's like I'm doing arithmetic and they're doing physics or something.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
But when it comes to breaking it down to that song.
Yeah.
We were shopping yesterday, and I'm going to answer your question in a minute, if I can remember what it was. But we were shopping yesterday and at a place called the Queen's Closet. Do you know where that is? And the lady in the store was playing Tony Bennett.
Uh-huh.
And that man, I mean, his voice just cuts right through and integrates with those arrangements. And I went, my gosh, you know, and he's not doing a bunch of riffs and all those acrobatics, and he's delivering the lyric and the flow of that line. I mean, it's so finessed that, you know, I had to just sit down. I didn't want to try on any more clothes. They were too tight anyway. So. But I was listening and she let it play again. That's a treasure right there. Yeah. And we have treasures in our midst right now. And we need to talk about them and lift them up and get involved with them. And, and let kids learn not only this kind of music, but come on, go over here. Let's see. Just be curious. You might discover something, you know.
Yeah. Yesterday, my guest was Phyllis Battle, who's you know, she was, I mean, she's still a singer, but in the days when we were young, she was really involved with like the jazz scene in Leimert Park, you know, Billy Higgins and that whole thing. And she was with the Fifth Dimension actually for 15 years. So we were talking about the older, the older cats who are like divine players, but they're not good at PR. That is not where they're good at.
No, because they just love being, they just want to get up there and blow, you know? It's like, and so many of them got lost because, I mean, I understand it.
Yeah.
So when that agent said, "Diane, why haven't you done more movies and stuff?" You know, I think it helps to have somebody, I don't care if it's your husband or an agent or what, somebody's got to say, "You got to do this." You know, I mean, even about my diet, nobody's going to come and make me work out, you know, just something you got to do on your own. So the best that I could do, especially after Adam Levine told me that Cathy Segal-Garcia wanted to interview me, I went, I got to get some new pictures. I'm doing all these selfies. And it's like, okay, there, everybody goes, yeah, that's a filter. So, you know, it's like, forget that, you know. And so I went to Jill Doherty down there next to the melodrama theater. She didn't even use a lot of lighting, you know. She used, when I shouldn't say lighting, because she did. It's like natural lighting. She'd let the window up and the light would come in and she'd have some, a bag. And it's like, then I saw the pictures and it made me feel like I now need to justify those pictures and do something else, you know. So we've been talking about this for a while, but having the pictures out now, it looks like... maybe I can play a lawyer or a CEO of a corporation or a judge, you know, or somebody's grandmother. I don't know, but with style, of course, you know, course. But anyway, so it's like, I'm kind of having fun about, yeah, let's do it one more time. You know?
So, okay, so this is a good segue back to my question. So the question was...
I'm glad you remembered, because yeah. I forgot.
Well, the question was, is satisfaction success? Basically, that's the question.
I think that if you can be satisfied... This is tricky, because are we talking about sitting on the laurels? Are we talking about... You're just fine just to look up and see the things you used to do and just go, that was really good. Okay, let's go in here and have dinner or what, you know.
But maybe that is success, you know. Maybe that's actually what we're supposed to have success in this
life. Things catch me by surprise when you think that, you know, I haven't done enough. I should be out there. I never had a hit record, but I have been always involved
in
things, and I have people and I have fans, and I love you dearly, all of you out there. Mm-hmm. But they're my fans, and it's not the burgeoning fan base that fills the Coliseum. But do you know how long I'd have to be on a diet to get ready for a Coliseum gig? I mean... I'm passion. I mean, if sometimes I wonder how it would be, and I've wondered about through my life, just being at home with the kids and maybe going back to teaching and going, now could I have done that? And I'm thinking of somebody in particular right now. I was thinking of Madonna, and I remember this, and I was still performing. This is before I got Sergeant Pe- I think it was before or after. Anyway, so you know how Madonna used to get on the floor and writhe all on the floor and do that whole thing? Well, one night I decided I'm tired of being sophisticated. I want to see what this feels like, you know? So like a virgin, you know, and all that. So, you know, because when you're in a cover band, you're going to do all those songs. So, you know, and so I went off the keyboard and I got down on the floor and I looked up. And I saw these guys looking at me like, and I went, nope, this is not working. But I got up and I brushed myself off and I went, next. We know I won't be riding on the floor. You know, they'd have to get me one of those things. I'm on the floor and I can't get up. You know, it's not going to work. I'm just going to stand there and be, you know, give me a nice outfit on and just do some good music that I love and enjoy and remember.
Well, that's what the audience wants. They want to see you enjoying yourself and doing what you do the best. And that's what they're getting off on, right?
Yeah, it is. I was coaching a class called Cabaret 805 with Grant Crowell, who passed last year. Uh-huh. And he was up at Cuesta, and this was, he asked several of us, Brett Mitchell, who's an accompanist, and Dave Ohm, and a few other people. And then he asked me to come in. So, you know, if I'm just going to accompany, if I hear something and it needs to go a certain way, because here's the answer to your question. I like lifting people up and seeing them profit. I don't know if it's profit, but take what I have to offer in suggestions. And then I see it coming to me and I just get excited for them, you know, because I'm just such a teacher, you know. When I said this in my bio, when I teach, I entertain, and I had to, because you know, you go into a school and high school kids go, now who is this?
Yeah, yeah.
You go, I want to show you who I am. So I got the goods with the music, but then there's things you have to do to get them motivated. So, you know, I get animated that way. So when I teach, I entertain. And when I entertain, it becomes satisfying to me to teach, leave them with something, and not just go out there and sing at them and say, wow, wasn't
yeah.
I? Didn't I look pretty? Didn't I sound great today? That to me, that's not enough.
Yeah.
I think when you know you've deserved that applause, you know, because there's some selflessness that has come across in all that you've worked so hard to do, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, working is just picking the right songs in the right keys.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and the right musicians, you know, we got such great musicians here in San Luis Obispo. Oh my God. Have you played with, where are you, bud? Are you in San Luis?
I'm in LA.
Well, doggone it. And let me talk about some LA people. I don't know why I thought you were up here.
No, but mostly I sing jazz, so that's my crowd, you know, and I know a lot of jazz people, but
yeah. And what I like is that smooth singing. It puts that point across. It's just, I just love it, you know. bring me my feather boa now. You know, you don't. We don't need feather boas. The feather boa is in our voices, so, right?
Yeah, so you're definitely a feather boa now.
As far as satisfaction, I think putting the show together and just getting out there and doing it again and going, let's do another one. I think with me, you got the be brave back there. I think I've been a little cowardly in some areas, because when I listen to the songs I used to do, because I don't sing that high anymore, and then I have to remember, well, Dionne Warwick doesn't sing that high anymore too, so get with it, chick, you know, like lower the keys and do something.
Yeah.
So, that is where my stepping out this time with the one more time. Maybe not the last time, but we're going to do it one more time.
Yeah. Well, that's pretty cool. That's just what I was asking. I was just asking, just because I've been thinking about satisfaction lately. I had this real big project that I was working on that I got kind of through the initial project just this last week. And I felt really satisfied. And then I was listening to something online. Excuse me.
Bless you. Bless you. Four times.
Oh. And they were talking about satisfaction. And that was kind of the focus of success. And I thought about that because that's what I felt last week. I just felt satisfied. I felt full. I felt I did the work. The people around me were high quality people and musicians, and everything was good. You know, I felt like I shared it with good people, and I mean, what was wrong? There's nothing wrong, you know, at all. So it just made me think about, yeah, This is
so. Are you like excited to do the next thing? Or
yes, or, I am. Over these last bunch of years, you know, so many people. I listen to a lot of spiritual stuff, like Eckhart Tolle and stuff like that. But so many people talk about. They're not the only people who talk about it, but the process being more valuable than the final product. And I really have worked on finding joy in the process, and I'm pretty good. I have a high tolerance level, and for problems. You know, problems. I have a high tolerance level. I can handle a lot of different things because I like improvisation in life and music and stuff. And so it's gotten better and better. Like, I like the process, you know, even if it's tiring or exhausting or whatever. The process itself is fun, you know.
Yeah, you know, you can get I'm glad that you said that, because sometimes the process for me has been like, I feel like I'm going into a war zone, you know, like, should I do this song or no, I don't want it to go like that. Or should I do this and come up with the arrangement first and then take it to the guys? Or should I do, you know, it's like, because I think when you're performing nightly, remember how we used to do in the old days? I mean, you start creating things on stage because
that's right.
I mean, and I remember writing songs on stage, and the guys would look at me and they go, oh, and it was like complete. But we're not on stage every night. So it's almost like I'm starting to think I was, the composer, I think his last, he was Ives.
Charles Ives?
I think so.
Classical?
Yes.
Yeah, Charles Ives.
Charles Ives. And he used to go in to his studio or wherever, and from 9 to 4 every day, composing something or doing something every day. And see, I haven't been doing that. I thought the pandemic was going to have me go in and do it. But then I got so into politics and, you know, bad taste in my mouth. I was like... And I got off and I said, well, then why don't you write some songs about that? But then, you know, I don't know. I just felt like I was frozen right with the pandemic.
I think a lot of people were like that in the beginning, especially.
Yeah.
I talked to so many people who said, yep, I just walk right by the practice room.
And you know what? So many people who did say, I'm going in. I don't care if they went in 3 times a week or every day.
Yeah.
They've come out with finished product. We have a couple here I'm kind of blanking out right now, but they said, Diane, we just decided that we're going to work on one song a month and record it and finish it and move on to the second song. And so by the time this is over, we'll have an album. And they did it.
That's cool.
Yeah. That's a plan, isn't it?
It's confrontable, you know. One song a month.
Just do one a month. And that means write it, finish it, go in and lay down the tracks, do your sweetening, or if you want strings or somebody, horns, whatever, you know, and you're done. Next.
Yeah, that's good.
It's like, how do you eat an elephant 1 inch at a time? How do you come up with an album? Just go in there and start doing something.
Well, that's kind of a cool thing that's come out of the pandemic, I think. People have been, and just the time, I guess, the time of our lives. But I think people are doing things differently. You know, like you see a lot more singles coming out, right? Yeah. You know, singles, little music videos. And I mean, that wasn't really happening before, you know.
Well, I see you got a lot of product out. I mean, I went, look at there, boy, she's killing it, you know.
Yeah, it's funny. It's interesting when I think, you know, my mom Well, my dad was a sax player. My mom had been a singer, but my dad, was an active sax player.
Yeah.
And for years, I thought that I got my impetus for moving forward from my dad, but it really wasn't. It was really from my mom, Jewish mom, she had twin daughters and me, and we were all singers. And, she was, "What are we going to do today? Okay." She was always, and my sisters turned out like me in that way. It was like, let's do stuff and community's important. And it was always, kind of outward moving.
My mother was like that. I mean, we said, she's a workaholic, but I mean, she couldn't, she was, she didn't stay still.
See,
You
and that's why you and
were
I
there every, I mean, community
yeah.
stuff, I mean, and thinking big. And if you did wanted to get in her way, or if you told her no, it was like, whenever you get a no from someone, go to someone who's qualified to give you a yes and move on, you know?
I have a friend named Cathy Cousins in Chicago who's a singer-songwriter and a great R&B with jazz influences singer, really great. Anyway,
Yeah.
her dad was a tailor for a lot of the Motown guys. And he told her, if you don't get in the front door, go around the back.
Okay.
And she did that all her career. And she's a successful person, and that's what she did. She went around the back all the time,
A lot of black artists have been doing that for years, so
Well.
you're giving her a lesson on that. But yeah, Cousins. Is it was his name Joseph Cousins?
Cousin,
I just spell.
Kosins. I don't know what her dad's name was.
Well, we have a Joseph Cousins street in Detroit, so I was wondering,
Oh.
is this Chicago? Yeah, just figured maybe.
Yeah, I don't know actually. I'm not really sure. And actually maybe it is. It's just Chicago, Detroit. I don't know. Sorry, Chicago, Detroit. It's like bad. By the way, my friend Roland wants to know, is your picture a mural in behind you?
No, you know what this is? It is a room divider.
Oh, very nice.
You know, and I found that I went, that's for me, take it, because, I did Sergeant Pepper. And I've met everybody except Ringo. I didn't meet George, but I might be meeting Ringo pretty soon. I met John when I first came to California at Perry Botkin's house. He wrote God Bless the Beast and the Children, and he was a songwriter and a composer. And it was at a party for, and I don't know why. John was a big fan of the singer. Every time I have an interview, I forget this guy's name. And oh my God. But anyway, so the party was for this singer, and John was there with May Pang. He had just broken up with Yoko. So I met him there. And then Paul, I've met him several times. He gave me a big kiss for Earth Day in 1993 on that thing. He went, come on out, Diane. And I thought, he knows my name. He's a, and he gave me a big kiss. So anyway, and then he's been writing with and recording some things with Steve Miller over the years. And then he stopped my daughter one day. Steve was doing another show, and Paul was doing another show somewhere else in LA, and we were at the Four Seasons. And Kendra had on a Motown shirt, standing in the shadows of Motown. And the main bass player for Motown was James Jamerson. And so when that movie came out, there was already a book, and James Jamerson Jr. gave us the book with the CDs, because they also had all the songs and all the renowned bass players in the industry play their favorite Motown song
Oh, cool.
on the CD.
Yeah.
And so we got t-shirts also. So it was James Jamerson, and it had all the bass players on the t-shirt. So Kendra, we were at the pool, and Kendra decided she wanted to go to the room and come back. And so we went, let's just go. I've been out long enough. And we see her talking to this guy. There's a group of people So we walked by and she caught up with us and we said, wow, who was that? Who were you talking to? She says, well, they wanted to know about my James Jamerson sweatshirt. And we said, well, Kitty said, well, it must be somebody that really knows music. She went, yeah, it was Paul McCartney. So it's right. So he went, Paul. So he goes and catches up with Paul in the workout room. And, you know, and, you know, because his name was on the T-shirt, too. And so and then I've seen Paul on some other occasions. But Kenny has met Ringo. He's working out at the Four Seasons in Chicago. And he said, this old guy was working up, doing the yoga next to me. He was taking up all the room. And I turned to him and I says, can you move over a little bit? And he kind of noticed everybody was looking and he never put it together. But Steve Lukather, a good friend of ours, who's a Toto.
Yeah, yeah.
Was on the road with him because Ringo has his own band of different musicians. So he said, hey, he called the room. He said, Steve, are you in the hotel? With Ringo, he says, yeah, we're out on the road. He says, I was just with him and I told Diana this old guy was like taking up all the room. So anyway, yeah, he says, don't worry about it. But they're gonna be in town here pretty soon. And that's gonna be Redondo. By the way, I don't know if you're a Steve Miller fan, but if you'd like to come to the concerts, let me know.
Wow, getting chills.
You don't want to hear Steve Miller. No, but anyway, if you'd like to go, you're welcome.
Cool.
They're going to be in Las Vegas also. And then I think Ringo is going to be in Vancouver. So we're going to meet him in Vancouver.
Wow, neat.
I'll get a chance to meet him. So at least I get 3 out of 4 guys that I met.
That's great. Hey, okay, so of course we have to talk about, well, Toby Simmons says hello.
Hi, Toby. Oh my God. She's great. She knows everybody.
I know. She's always introducing me to people. let's talk about Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. Tell us about that, because that's such a huge, big part of your life. And yeah, it's wonderful.
Yeah, like I told you before we got on, I was supposed to open up after my ABC Universal Child album came out. And David Pomerantz, who wrote Trying to Get the Feeling Again.
David Pomerantz? I know him.
Well, he was my producer.
Really?
Barry Fosman. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. And
Barry, God bless him, he just passed this last year. But so I was preparing to go out on the road and open for George Benson.
Oh, yeah.
And I even got the ABC deal because of Living Without Your Love. What's his name? With all the hair.
Oh, God, you're asking the wrong person. Out there, if you know the answer.
Yeah, they know who it is.
Living Without Your Love.
So all of a sudden, Otis Smith over at ABC Records said, listen, let's talk about who your management is going to be. And then the A&R guy over at... you know what, I need to go to sleep and wake up again or something. anyway, the A&R guy over there came in and said, listen, there, can you come into my office and just stand there? And then he leaned back on his phone and he said, yeah, I'm looking at Lucy right now. And he had the inside of my album cover open, because that's really a better picture than the cover.
Yeah.
And so he said, yeah, we'll send her over. So I said, well, what was that about? He said, they've been looking for someone to play Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, and Carly Simon doesn't want to do it. And they've been scouring all the record companies. And so now your record's done. I'm going to send your record over there. And I went, okay. And here's the other part. There was a costume designer who worked on my album. And when I told her, you know, I think I'm going to ask my manager about this Sgt. Pepper movie. She said, well, you're not going to get it. And I went, I'm not. And she went, yeah, because my friend Donna Summers is going to try out for that. So you're not going to get it. And I was like, so one thing.
Don't tell me I'm not going to get it. That's what you're like.
I said, okay. So then I went back to my manager and I said, hey, Dick, what about, you get me? He says, yeah, I went to school with one of the casting directors. So, you know, so the synchronicity of it all began to work out. Yeah. And so I went over and I talked to Beth and Fern Champion, and they took me in a room, and then in comes Michael Schultz with a camera, and they had a piano player and one other assistant there, and they just wanted to film me. And I went down to Fredericks of Hollywood because I figured I guess this part is supposed to be sexy or something. So I got my fishnet hose, but those weren't the guys that made me sexy. All they had was underwear in there. I went two doors down because there was a Capizio's either next door or two doors down. From that. And I went in and I said, I guess I should just maybe think of some tights and leotards. And the guys went, forget about it. The disco thing is coming in. Let us show you what's coming in from New York. They're not wearing it here yet. So he gets me this leotard with the entire back open, you know, where you just tie it back here, all with the lace all the way down. And then I had my fishnets from Frederick, of course. And then I said, well, what am I supposed to put over that? And they said, here. And do you know that it was a shawl, a little Jersey shawl. And the other day I was looking for a top and I pulled, what is this? And that shawl is there. I mean, it fits me like a tiny little cape now, but but I went, there's this shawl. Maybe I should auction this thing out. No, but no. And they said, I said, what am I supposed to do with it? He said, honey, tie it around your hips and tie a knot and have your leg out over here and go to that audition. So that's what I did. And I walked out, you know, I used to work out a lot in those days, but I walked out on the set at Paramount and the guys, the gaffers and all the guys working on the sets and everything, they all came out. And I just figured, I'm going to fluff my hair up and I'm just going to carry that badge like, this is my part.
Yeah.
And I was like, hi, fellas, you know, and they applauded me. And I went, boy, this is what's going on here? And then we started the audition and the keyboard player, of course, you know, I am a keyboard player. So if you're not playing it right, my teacher, Gene, started to lock in and I'm going, you know, I'm saying, okay, pick it up right here and play it like this. And I go over and I show him how to play it because everybody that came into that audition, and I won't mention names right now, I'll tell you in private, but they took the I'm the singer that's going to drape myself on the piano, you know, like torch singer, and I don't know what else they did, but I had dance and I had choreographed for high school because I told you about West Side Story and all that. So when I went in, I was already choreographed, and I did my own thing, and they weren't expecting. I don't know what they were expecting. It was the first time I had auditioned for a movie, so I did what I thought you would do to audition for theater, right? So, and then they said that when Robert Stigwood looked at the dailies, he said, stop, go back to the girl that's bossing the keyboard player. So, you know, I don't know. You never know what works. But they liked that I could move.
Yeah.
Because when I see these dancers nowadays, I think you have to be like a gymnast or something to do some of this stuff.
Yeah.
Or been a hip one of the street dancers. And things were just changing. You know, disco came in about, 78, 79?
Yeah.
Because they took us to a screening of Saturday Night Fever. And, you know, I just saw all the star studded, everybody was there. But it's like, I see the way they were dancing, it's pretty smooth, but nowadays,
I know, it's crazy. So let's see, I wanted to ask you a question. So I believe it or not, I never saw the movie. I
Well,
don't know where I was, but I never saw the movie. So what happens in the movie? What part are you? You're obviously Lucy in the sky with diamonds, but are you dancing and singing? Are you in throughout the movie?
I'm the bad girl. I mean, I'm BDs, big deals, the president of the record companies, star and girlfriend,
Okay.
I'm like Diana Ross to Berry Gordy, or let's see, who else can I think of? All I can think of. But everybody kept saying, the part is like Gwen Verdon and Damn Yankees. And I'm going, oh, it's like they like Anita and West Side Story energy. And then they said, like Tina Turner in the movie that he did, the rock and roll movie, The Who with The Who. Oh, God.
Wow.
With Elton John, and I went, oh, well. So when I saw Tina, I just went, okay, that'll be my inspiration for this role. So when I come on, it's Lucy and the Diamonds. Now I must show you this. This is the group Stargard, and they played the Diamonds. So it was like Diana Ross and the Supremes, or Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, So they played the Diamonds, and so we're in the studio, and they're discovered. BD discovers or hears about a new group that's living on the farm, like Pleasantville or something, and they're singing, and they made a recording, and they sent it to the radio, to the studio, and so now they're going to make this group a hit, and it's Peter Frampton and the Bee Gees, and Dougie, who is played by Paul Nick Paul Nichols, Paul. Yes. Well, he plays their cousin manager. And so they are being sent to come to California, picked up, flown in, and they're gonna be the new thing. So Lucy's assignment from the beginning is to greet them. And so when you see her first, she's a chauffeur, and she's kind of hitting on Peter Frampton. And then Dougie's hitting on her. And then the next time you see them, then she's also driving the car, and now she's on a motorcycle with the motorcycle guys and the Diamonds, And then you see her down on Rodeo Drive as Cleopatra in the window. So it's like all of that is going, this montage of different costumes I got to do. You even see me with a blonde wig on and short shorts being a street walker. So anyway, and then some people say, you did all those parts? Yeah, that was me. So they did.
That's cool, yeah.
So that's how it starts. And then I am the one that's in the studio to help the guys feel comfortable. And I've got my own record deals and things. And next time you see us is Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds up on the billboard on Sunset coming to life, because Sandy Farina, who played Strawberry Fields, is coming to rescue her boyfriend from Lucy, and she's heard about all this stuff. So she gets on the bus and comes to Hollywood and looks up, and the billboard comes to life, and she's going, oh my God. So she makes her way to the studio after she's freaked out about that, and the guys are in there singing, oh, darling, if you need me. And they see her and they go, wow, what's going on? Because back home, a bad guy got there, and he's messing up everything in the city. He's turning it very corrupt and very like Hollywood. But they wanted to come back home and save the city. So it just, and then you have Donald Pleasance is in it. He plays Big Deal, which is like Robert Stigwood, and he was wonderful to work with. I mean, God, he's done everything. You know who he is, don't you?
Wow, this so I gotta go watch this movie.
Well, it may be tedious. I mean, there's some people that say it's a cult, you know, classic.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. It sounds totally like a cult classic. But
yeah, but you know, I just want to do one more thing before it's all over.
Well, you acted after that, right?
In, I did some theater. I worked with Ted Lange from The Love Boat. You know, he's got a lot of theater in his back pocket. And I went to New York to try out for something, but I, you know, it's like, I'm going to have to go through my books. You know, I used to keep logs of everything I did, because it seems like after that, the movie was delayed, and then there was a lot of politics with everything. And I just, by the time we had the premiere in New York, that was lovely. And then I just began to question whether I should do movies or whether I should just go and start, keep writing music.
Yeah. You know?
And then there was enough time that passed, and then my husband's record deal started going. He was not with Steve Miller at first. But he had signed with Robbie Eubop and Kid Lightning. And then the next thing I know, Steve Miller took everything that was on the Robbie Eubop album and made it. This is when Abracadabra was breaking really big. And next thing I know, we were all in Europe going to the Montreux Jazz Festival. And, you know, that was the 80s, and the music was changing so much. I mean, you had disco in the 70s, and now you got the new music in the 80s. And, you know, I wasn't really feeling either one of those, you know. I remember telling David Pomerantz at some point, I said, let's do this song. I want to do Dance and Lover. And I'm saying, and he says, yeah, that's disco. We don't know how long it's going to be around. So my motto, and I said in an interview not too long ago, I said, you know what, I'm gonna go with what Ted Lasso says: be curious and not judgmental. And get out there and just try some stuff. Try it on. Yeah. See how it feels. I mean, after all, I got down on the floor and tried to be Madonna. It didn't work. But
you were curious, goddammit.
Oh, I was curious, all right. And those guys looking at me were curious, too. And I went, I'm not, you know, I'm not going to be the one, you know.
Definitely have to have a sense of humor to be curious, right?
You know, I'm in my mind, I'm kind of a comedian, but you know, I won't say comedian. I'm humorous at times.
You could probably be a comedian, I bet.
Yeah, somebody did. Hey, I need a writer. So,
right.
You know, so what I'm doing now is putting together memoirs of a daughter, and I decided to go about it a musical way, taking the music from Stax, because my uncle was in Booker T and the MGs, and he co-wrote Green Onions with Steve Cropper. He's a founding member with Steve Cropper, Booker T, Jones, and Al Jackson, who has passed. And then Doug Dunn came along after that. But so they're all in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. My mother's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I don't know if I'll ever be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but there's a legacy to carry on, and at least I can talk about it, you know? So I think I'll talk about my first recital and what my dad said and what happened. And I was even thinking, if I have a little pin spot on a little girl from the community playing the piano with her long dress on. I mean, I just couldn't wait to wear that long dress, you know. And then going from there into, you know, hearing dad practice in the front room with his jazz musicians and my Aunt Gladys, you know, the only thing she knew, I told you everybody played piano, right?
Yeah.
Gladys, they lost their keyboard player one night. And so my dad said, you got to play. And she went, I don't know but one song. And it was Tenderly, The Evening Breeze.
Oh, gosh. Wow. I'm sorry.
Good.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Ladies and gentlemen. So she played Tenderly over and over again, and dad was going to take her off the, you know, say, okay, enough of that. But the club owner loved Gladys so much, he said, if you fire her, you're firing the whole band. So they played Tenderly maybe 1,000 times that night. I don't know.
Yeah.
So.
I'm sorry. You know what? Why I came the music on, because my friend posted the finale of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club.
Ooh, everybody was in that.
Yeah, and I you know, and you're kind of right in the front there, but I was just I didn't. Sometimes they'll take me off if I don't have licensing, you know.
I don't think I've seen that on YouTube.
I don't think this particular Calvin. It doesn't sound like a real.
Bummer.
Harold Channing?
Oh. Yeah. And Gwen Verdon was there too. Oh, that guy's from Detroit.
Okay. Here you are.
I'm not far from hell and ready to write next to Pittsburgh.
God, everybody was there.
Yes. Cindy Riverton at the beginning. That's Robert Stigler with his album. And that's Jose, yeah.
Wow.
The Jimi Hendrix, Peter Allen, Sean and I. Yeah, the boys, yeah. And you see, hey, do you see George Benson?
Here you are. Next to George Burns.
Yeah, I met George Burns at that party where I met John Lennon.
Connie Stevens.
Yeah.
Good man.
Stephen Bishop. Alan O'Day he came to our wedding and filmed our wedding for us. Of course, he had his picture at the end of the conference. That's, I know. Oh, there's Keith Garrity. Did you see that guy with the mustache?
Yeah.
That guy was in, you know, the Woody Allen movie where he's putting cocaine on the table and squeezes it.
Yes. Yes.
That's the guy. No, his name was John. Okay.
I want to bring up some pictures of you because you know, it's just kind of cool. I know you sent me some pictures, but I like just looking at these, you know.
Well, there's a ton of pictures there.
Quite beautiful.
Yeah, that was when I finished the record. That was a photo session for the record.
This was the Lucy in the Sky, right?
Yes. Before they put the bra pads in the uniform. I mean, in the costume.
I like that picture a lot.
Which one?
This one.
You do?
No, I do. It's just like, yeah, okay. This is adorable too, gosh.
That was... Are those all my teeth? Yeah.
You're pretty young there. Very cute. Yeah, really cute. How about talking about your mom a little bit?
Oh, gosh. You don't want to do a part two?
Yeah, I know. It actually.
Okay. I'm going to make it. I'm going to try to make it as I can. We started out talking about when my mom and dad met, and she had been a 10-year-old or 11-year-old queen at the fair, and then she was a high school queen, met my dad, they got married, and then my dad with his musician, you know, musicians hitting the road and being gone all the time, especially if you're playing jazz, you know,
and
you're not making a whole lot of money. You're on the road a lot and gone a lot.
Yeah.
And so dad wasn't sending a lot of money home. And so I got to tell you one thing about my mom, because she did it with everything in her career.
Yeah.
If you gave her $5, she'd know how to make curtains and everything else out of that $5, and they would be gorgeous. You know, she knew how to take things and put it together even with outfits, because she wasn't a skinny woman. She was not like Lizzo. She was, she'd say, I'm an Amazon woman, you know, because she was like, she was almost 6 foot tall. I'm 5'4".
Oh, wow.
And we got tall people on both sides of the family, but my grandmother, Ida, was like 4'10". So we got some shorties in the family. And then I my uncle, we called him Big Red, but they were all Uncle Wilton and Uncle Milton, and they were all tall, you know. But, and then my mother was tall, and her brother was tall. And then the shorties were the rest of them on her side of the family. But she knew how to dress and make things look wonderful. And so she would have fashion shows. She had a group of people who wanted to do things in the community and uplift people. Now, this is before radio.
Yeah.
She didn't have anything else to do, but she had her friends, and they would, you know, they loved to wear beautiful hats, and, you know, and she had a friend who used to make the outfits, you know, so they would put on fashion shows, you know, and go, and they would go to, you know, the Peabody Hotel had the Lansky brothers were not in the Peabody Hotel. They were down the street from it, but the Lansky brothers were the ones that outfitted Elvis.
Okay.
And all of the jazz blues guys, when they get those suits on, and their shop was on Beale Street or around that area. So when Elvis came, he used to see the way the blues and the jazz guys were dressed. Yeah. And so that's why you saw him just a little bit different when he went on the Ed Sullivan Show. Because the Lansky brothers, you know, they put them together, you know. And of course, his musical style came from hanging out on Beale Street. He loved gospel music and that whole thing. So, and he used to open up for my dad and a couple of times. Uh-huh. I know how jazz musicians are. You know, my dad was the one that says, you know, he can't play the guitar, you know, so, you know, immediate judgment, right?
Yeah.
So it's interesting that they both ended up being managed by Sam Phillips, dad first. And then, like I said, dad, Elvis was what dad was thought he was going to become, but the music wasn't lining up. The boogie woogie, I mean, Elvis was right place, right time, everything.
Yeah.
So anyway, back to my mother. So while all of that is happening in my dad's life, I was born, and then my sister, the second child, was born, and mom's still trying to make do with everything. But then she wanted more out of life than being at home.
Yeah.
Because she was a worker. She worked. If she wasn't going to be a nurse, she was going to do something. You know, she got that from her mother. So my dad went out on the road, and she went, Luther, I got to have more money than this. So over a time, about around, I'd say 52, 53, the radio station, which was white owned by John Pepper, and Bert Ferguson, who was from Tennessee, Pepper died, and he decided, I'm going to change. We have an unserved community here in Memphis, and I'm going to try something. Now, you know, you're coming out of the late 40s and 50s and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And it's like, who was the president before Ike? I forgot. During that administration, here we go. We know how to sing a song, but you know, so I think I'm gonna have a coaxer here over on the side. So these were very tumultuous times.
Yeah.
And the lady who just died, Christine Spindell, she said Bert Ferguson told me after going to one of the radio conventions that he was going to make a change, and he was going to put she said, please excuse me, but a colored person on the air, because she didn't want to say black, you know.
Yeah.
That's her generation, you know. So she said, and so he decided he was going to put this teacher, a scholar, Nat D. Williams, on the air. In fact, Wheelin' on Beale by Cohen, I got it right over here. It was released quite a few years ago. They were going to do a movie about it, but it kind of like Driving Miss Daisy, you know, but to talk about radio in the day. It's called Wheelin' on Beale. And the guy that wrote it was an engineer at WDIA in Memphis. And she said that Bert Ferguson said, I'm going to put this Black person on the air. And she was so excited because she was Christine's father was her mother's sisters. They were women who worked. They did not sit at home and raise kids and do laundry, you know. They were career women. And her father was a very strong man. And she told me this story. And I mean, this is going to go into what I'm telling you. Excuse me. She said, some of the kids, the little colored kids, Black kids were coming back, and the kids I was with from grade school were making fun of them and calling them names. And she said, so I didn't know what to do, so I started doing it too. And she said, my dad saw that, and he pulled me. He took me by my arm and took me on my front porch, and he said, and she told Kenny and I this, we got it on film. She goes, those people have it hard enough for you to be there adding to this, and you're never to do this again. And the sisters, the aunties and every, they felt the same way. And this is the South, you know? She said, I never did it. I was a worker, and my dad was a good man, and he taught me those values. And so when Bert Ferguson said, he said, we were driving back from the convention, and all the guys were sleeping in the back, and he said, I'm gonna change the programming, and I'm gonna put a Black DJ of color, you know, during that time, on the air. And she went, oh, she was so excited, you know, because they were playing classical music in the afternoon and doing crop reports and playing it was not called country western music in those days. It was, for lack of a better term right now, what we might consider like a hillbilly music, you know.
Yeah.
Please forgive me. I forgot the word. Like, I'm forgetting a lot of stuff today. You're getting me down right now. So she said, and we were dying. We had to do something. And so every day, she said, well, I would pass them in the hallway. Weeks turned to a month, and a month turned to 2 months. And I started getting like really excited, and I'm going, when are you going to do this? And he goes, she said, and then finally Nat D. Williams showed up, and he came in, and I knew it was going to happen. And he sat there, and you know, they had those big microphones, you know, the ones with the, the big microphone. And he sat down, and everybody was very quiet. And she said she couldn't stand it anymore. So she went and took the microphone, and she plunked it down in front of him, and he started laughing. And he had this very unique laugh. And it read, everybody in the city heard this laugh, and they knew it was Nat D. Williams. And they went, so people who were working and you know, as maids and so forth, heard that. Is that Nat D. Williams, you know? And the next thing you know, she said, we played Duke Ellington and, you know, some things like that. But now we were playing all this different music. And so the ladies, and she told me, she was the little white lady that used to go, and I think she was married to a Jewish guy. And, but she used to go to all the church ladies meetings and see what they needed and what they wanted, because they wanted to be community radio.
Yeah,
I mean, they would help you. As my mother said, we would get calls. We got calls one day from a woman saying, my husband lost his teeth and he can't find them. And it was at that dance over at so-and-so. She said, we found his teeth. We've had people calling saying, I don't know where my husband disappeared. And they would find the husband. And then, but what they would do is also, they would put on the Goodwill review. And they would have at the Ellis Auditorium, and they would have all the stars with the hit records, you know, and they would use that money to buy kids uniforms for the baseball team and stuff. And what was really interesting is that here is the stage, and on this side, it is gigantic arena. The Black people sat here, the stage was there, and the white people sat on the other side, and everybody's facing each other. It's ridiculous, isn't it? But that's the way it was in those days.
Yeah.
And so, but they would raise that money. In fact, Elvis showed up at one of those when there's a picture of Rufus Thomas with an Indian headdress on. And and they have themes every year. And so everybody dressed like Native Americans, you know, and the little kids would come on stage, and then Elvis came to that one. I wasn't old enough to go, so I missed out on all that stuff until later. But my mom tells a story that she was in there like doing her hair and everything and putting her little feather in and whatever. And I got pictures of that. I'll send it to you. But she said Elvis comes in and you know, my mother, she's so good, you know, because we had actors and stuff and her the dancers on her side of the family. And my mother, she was never one to, she wasn't giddy, you know, she was very observant. And it was, she never like did big grins or like I'm doing, you know. She called me silly, you know. Was very reserved, and she Elvis comes in and he starts, you know, doing, you know how they slick their hair back again.
Yeah,
and she's sitting at her makeup table, and so she looks up at him, and so she said, and you know what he said to me? He said, "I'm good looking, ain't I?" And she said. Oh, I know what you mean, because I'm gorgeous, you know. Like I'm good looking too. I forget what you told that story in the car. Now, when you said that to Elvis, you know, but I mean, she said some interesting things to presidents and everything. But that's only so okay. So I'm gonna back up. Okay. So she was on the radio, and they started calling her Princess Premium Stuff.
Now, wait a minute. Oh, wait, I'm a little lost. So the fellow that you were talking about, he was on the radio, and then did your mom come in that period?
No, she didn't. Thank you very much. So, no, they had to start configuring who was going to be on the radio, and they got one lady. You know, mom said in those days, the only thing women could do on the radio was give advice or be a homemaker and give you recipes. That's all you could do on the radio. So there was a lady there. She dressed beautifully with the furs and everything. And she was quite softic, you know? Uh-huh. A little bit bigger than softic. But her name was Willa Monroe. And she would come with the recipes. And of course, Christine Spindell said, boy, she would cook so much food at the radio station. We all got fat, and, you know. And she said she would just come in and be beautifully dressed. And I said, well, did she cook the food? She said, no, she just gave the recipes and everybody loved her. And I don't know what else Ella did. I cannot imagine that she just gave recipes. So there's some people that I have to call, you know, because I mean, she was in those fashion shows too. You know, these were the days that if you were too skinny, they figured you must be starving to death or something.
Yeah, so yeah.
Women in those days who had a little bit on them, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You knew they had supper. So, you know, so but this is my point of view. I don't want anybody calling me about this. Okay? So, but they made the most of what they had, and they were proud, you know. So, so they had a contest because Willa was falling upon some bad health. Mm. And she'd been there a quite a while and doing other things. I don't know what else she did prior to going on radio. She might, because WDIA started with Nat D. Williams in 1948. So there was that time between that and Willa Monroe being there. And then they had a contest because Willa was falling on the health. This was 1953. And they wanted to have women, young women, come and try out as a replacement for Willa Monroe. Yeah. And so Christine Spindell tells me that my mother came up, and when she filled out everything, she just said, "I'm going to be somebody." You know, that sounds like my mom. "I'm going to be somebody." Like, okay. My mother was not chosen out of that group. Versia Starr McKinney was chosen, and she was wonderful and a very good friend of Christine's for a year or two. But her husband was a minister, and he did not want her on the radio. So she left and went to Chicago. And there was one other lady there who was working, and they tried her out for a while. And then they said, "Call that pretty one, that one that said she's going to be somebody." So then that's when my mother came. And so they had those Goodwill reviews, and the one with the Indian princess, and they called her Princess Premium Stuff, which she hated. She hated that name. And they called her Pre and Premium Stuff. And she went, you know, they took her, they gave her a homemaker show. And she said at the Paley Center, Museum of Television and Radio in Beverly Hills, when she was inducted into the She Made It initiative, they chose 50 women in radio, television, media, 50 women each year for 3 years. And so my mother was in the one in 2006. It was called She Made It. And that she was inducted with Betty White and Dr. Joyce Brothers and quite a few women, some of the first women who were in sports TV. And then posthumously, there were other people that were inducted. But she said on when it came up her turn and they had her on the dais with other people in radio, they said, "How was it being a woman in radio?" And she said, "I tell people all the time, be a woman in radio, you have to think like a man, act like a lady, and work like a dog." And now they wanted me to be a homemaker. And I said, I can't cook. And so I was there with my daughter, and I went, "I thought mom cooked pretty well." But anyway, so she says, "I told them I can't cook." She said, so, and they called me Premium Stuff. And she said, so they moved me to the Honeymooner show, and that Premium Stuff, I wasn't having it anymore. So finally I said, "I want to spin the records too and have my own directed show," which was, you know, how dare you? I'm looking at Be Brave. Oh, wait, we're talking chutzpah beyond chutzpah. Okay. She was my Yiddish mama, although she was Catholic. But anyway, so.
What kind of Yiddish?
Okay. We'll talk about that later. She just hung in there and insisted. And they thought, who is she to demand? She acts like she's a queen or something. So they started teasing her about being, here come the queen. You know, she thinks she's going to be. So she insisted and she persisted, and they gave her a show. She spun the records. She had her message. She had all, and she was good at like, "I'm going to put you into something that you can't shake loose, whether you want to or not. I bet you, yeah." You know, I mean, and she was good at, you know, slogans and branding and all that. And so they gave her her show. And then the guy said, "I'm going to call you Princess Premium." She says, "No, you're not. No, you're not. I don't care what you do. I don't care if you rhyme it or whatever, but you're going to have dead air." And so then there was, the clock was ticking, and he said, "Ladies and gentlemen, Martha Jean." And she mom said, and I looked at him, and he said, "Martha Jean, the queen." And she went, "Yeah."
Wow, discerning moment. Wow, that's really.
Yeah, and you know, and the funny thing is, people would call into the radio station. I was there with when my daughter was 5 years old, and I heard her and said, "Queen, how did you get your name?" And she said, "You know, I've told you people this a million times." She says, "You know, we didn't have anything, so we had to name ourselves. So there was Count Basie and there was Duke Ellington. So they called me the Queen. And now I believe it. And I'm a legend, not only on in my own mind, but I am a pioneer and an icon." And I went, "Wow." You know, sometimes you just have to declare yourself. And she did.
That's great.
And she trademarked it too.
Wow.
She trademarked it, and so
Gosh, you know, now that you say it, I never even thought about Duke Ellington and Count Basie. Yeah, I've never even
the
thought about that.
Empress of Soul, and you know, all these names, because what else? If life is hard, you choose a name for yourself. Naming yourself is very important. I
Wow,
mean,
what could we name ourselves?
oh my gosh. Maybe we should put it to our listening public, which what they should, what we should name ourselves. You know, like when I went on the radio after my mom passed, because nobody knew she was going to pass, and so they said, "Donna, you got to go on." So I went on, you know, just to talk to the people, and I had done some radio, doing the news at at Western Michigan University at WDIV, you know, the wider radio W. IDR, wider radio. But, you know, I thought, okay, I can sing, but sustaining like an hour talking, well, I think the people listening to me right now know that I can talk my head off. So I.
You're a good talker. But you know what? You're a really good talker, but you listen too. So you can talk a lot, but you can be interrupted, which to me is important.
That is that. Thank you. Thank you, I will accept. Okay. So, I mean, you got to do that. I mean, it'd be boring. Are people like writing into you telling you that I'm talking too much or anything?
In fact, Tara Mitchell said, Martha Jean, the Queen, love it. Great stories, Diane. Thanks so much for sharing.
Tara. Okay. Yeah, Tara just I think she just did something with her foot here the other day. Here's blessing you for complete healing, Tara. Okay. So now, so where was I?
Let's see.
Oh, so I didn't know that I could talk. And so they said, "Diane, just go on and say something." So I basically said, I'm not my mom. And I'll tell you, my mom left beautiful clothes, beautiful hats, beautiful shoes, everything. And even though we wore the same size, you know, when you walk in your shoes, there's a certain angle that you know, your shoe will take on because of how your gait is. And I'll tell you, I try to walk in my mom's shoes, and I got some in there right now. And they hurt my feet so much, and they're not too small. It's just I walk different than my mom. You know, so that's a little parable about walking in someone's shoes for a minute. But I did say to them, "I will share with you, I need to talk to you as much as you need to talk to me." She raised the city, she raised me, you know, and many of you are friends. And so let's just talk. And so I left it up to Jay Butler, a DJ who's still there. Now he needs to be interviewed. I mean, the stories, oh my God. But he just programmed the music, and everyone was there. So then all of a sudden, so a couple of the guys started calling me. "I can see it now, Martha Jean the Queen and Detroit's own Lady Di." You know, so I got, the people in my neighborhood call me Lady Di. "Hey, is Lady Di?" So you know, it's okay.
Yeah,
So you'll be the diva, the lady. Is that what we're gonna do?
well, actually, I people have called me the queen, not to take your mom's name, but I guess the queen of the jazz community or so, I don't know. I don't think I am, but
Well, then we got to be
I
two queens, because then let's go up on the stage and la-di-da. Oh,
Oh, you have your cousin B. Walker is here.
Oh, Beverly, she's in Texas. Hi, Beverly. That's my cousin. That's my Uncle Wilton's oldest daughter. And my uncle, we used to call him Uncle Fat. I don't know how he got the name, but all families have nicknames for it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we had Uncle Fat, and he had a place called the Sharecropper. And I'm trying to think of the keyboard player. Maybe she can remember the country keyboard player. Kenny should be in here right now. But whoever he was, he used to play there. But he also had a place called Stein's Place.
Okay.
And I think he had the tiki room too. So even though my Uncle Fat didn't play music, not that I ever knew, all the stars and everything would come to his clubs.
Yeah.
And so we have a brass note on Beale Street for the Steinberg family. Wow. So we're trying to get a separate one for my mom, you know, but they keep saying, well, she's in there. And they actually have my name at the end of it. So, you know, when you go to Memphis, go to the old W.C. Handy movie show. It's still there, theater, and they have this brass note with all of our names on it. And so the Earth, Wind, and Fire got there because the white Beverly, help me. All the people from Memphis have their notes down there on Beale Street.
Okay.
So there's a lot of stories going along with that. And so my mother, when I heard her say, I know some of you don't believe me, but and I'm not a legend in my own mind, but I'm a pioneer. And she was.
Yeah.
She was a pioneer. And so we're trying to, right now, my dream is to get a street name for her in Memphis, because remember the guy, Matt D. Williams, who was at WDIA? He has a street name for him. Ernest Withers, the guy that did all the photography, anything that you saw, he was the publicity, political, the guy that even took pictures after Martin Luther King was shot at the Lorraine Hotel. And his family is still carrying on a legacy. Like I said, I'm going to do it one more time. But we also have my cousin's son, my cousin Brenda Steinberg, Steinberg Gibson, who used to sing backup at Stax Records also for a lot of the acts. Her son, Ice Gibson, is a performer. So we still have some up-and-comers who make a name for themselves. You know, carrying it on, got to do it. It might be heavy, but
it's a pretty full life. Yeah.
Yeah. I can't be at Memphis this weekend, but we're going to go back because there's some wonderful things that are in the works for Memphis and Detroit that need to happen. There's a historical marker for WDIA.
Yeah.
And so Nat D. Williams is on there, and my mother's name is on there, And then at the Stax Museum, you know what Stax Museum is. Mm-hmm. Boyd Axton and it makes up Stax. Forgive me, everybody. If you know, type it in and Cathy, no, but they have a museum in Memphis where Stax Records is. Isaac Hayes was on Stax, and Otis Redding was on Stax, and Carla Thomas, Rufus Thomas, the Barquets, the Marquis, so many people. Was Wilson Pickett there? I'm not sure, but. So there are a lot of people there that whenever you go, you have to go there. Like when you go to Cleveland to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
You should always make sure you go to those places. And then the Paley Center in Beverly Hills, next time you come out, it will come out. You're in Beverly Hills. Or you're in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Well, they moved, I know. And when the pandemic hit, they were doing everything virtually. So I don't know if they got a new building yet, but whenever you want to go there, you can just bring up the dais, put it in Martha Jean, the Queen Steinberg's name, and it all comes up. So
cool.
She's in the Smithsonian too.
I would imagine so.
And I want to tell you one other thing. You know Aretha Franklin, the hat that she wore at Obama's inauguration, the one with the big bow?
Yeah.
Well, we have tons of Mr. Song's millinery's hats. And that was a Mr. Song, Miss Luke Song made that hat for Aretha. In fact, after she came back and they had a birthday party for her, they had a cake that was made just like that. Somebody just told me that in Detroit. And so that hat was lifted up and taken. It's at the Smithsonian Institute. So, and I don't think I'm jumping the gun here, but I'm sharing it with you, darling.
All right.
It's just between us and whoever's listening right now. But Disney and Epic is coming out with a series. You know how they have those series, you know, and they have different episodes, you know.
Yeah.
And it's called Little America, and it's about immigrants who have come to the United States and who have succeeded. And one of those people, one of those immigrant families will be Mr. Song's millinery. And so they went to Luke and his mother and said, we want to do a thing. You know, we know you made Aretha's hat. And so Luke Song said, we made that hat. And I got to tell you, when that hat, he told me when that hat was on at the inauguration, it's like the next day, it was like the phone rang. They had like almost 4,000 orders for that hat. The whole thing, he said the phone never stopped ringing.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm keeping my Mr. Strong hats. We don't know how valuable those would be. But he told me, he said, Aretha made that hat very, you know, popular, but we want to tell you that the person responsible for making us successful, because she used to wear our hats and people would call in to the radio station, Queen, I love that hat you wore. Where did you get that hat? Or they would call, did you see that hat the Queen was wearing? You know, because they wear hats there. They wear them in London and they wear them down south and at the churches. But and they're gorgeous hats. So she was like a walking ad for them. And she never charged them anything. Maybe later they worked out something, but she would wear those hats. And he said, Martha Jean McQueen is responsible for our success. And so the series might be coming out in the fall, and they've already started filming that, and they've already cast the role for Martha Jean McQueen.
Really?
I'm not telling who's playing. Oh, yeah. So, you know, who knows what's going to happen, but I'll tell you what. When it comes out, I will call you. Hey, Cathy, it's on. It's on tonight, okay?
Cool.
I'll just send you an email and let you know. And I think it's going to be really good. I'm very excited. And so when hopefully, look, it might come out in the summer, but I haven't heard that. I'm thinking maybe the fall.
Yeah.
And they wanted to do it 2 years ago, but then the pandemic hit and it was like, shush, that, you know, everybody quit everything then. So I'm excited about that. Excited about my musical presentation. And I'll tell you, I don't know, but I think we should get together and work out a couple of songs.
Oh, I'd love that.
I know you're going to be singing up here and I'll sing down here.
Okay. It's fine with me. Excuse me.
All right.
A little water.
I told you Kenny put something in here, didn't I?
You did. It's pretty nice.
Yeah, I think I'm going to go for it now.
Well, we're actually coming to the last 5 minutes. Believe it or not, 2 hours has passed. Cool. I always say that.
Thank you so much for this.
Thank you so much for being on. It's really fun to talk to you, and you're such a your spirit is so beautiful. It's just lovely. It's just, just big and open-hearted and fun, and thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'm glad that I didn't come here hungry. We've been doing intermittent fasting. I think that's why I got my little spirit coming on, because once you start like not eating so much and your body goes, oh, we're doing a cleanse. So here it is. But you know what? Thank you. Thank you so much that I was able to do this. And
Yeah.
I'm telling anybody, the neti pot is great, but if you get Neil Med in NEILMED, Neil Med, and it's that little bottle, and it's squeezy, it's real soft, and you put that saline stuff in there with the, oh, I mean, you'll get 2 hours out of it, because I just did.
It's nice. It's kind of it's different from the neti pot. It's
Yeah,
fun. It's easier, first of
I
all.
think so.
Yeah, you squirt the water and the saline and it goes around and comes out. And it's the neti pot is, you have to hang over the sink and
We got the neti pot, everybody.
I haven't done that. I should do it actually.
Bless you.
Well, I'm just gonna tell people that what I usually do is I do Monday through Wednesday live, usually, and then Thursday through Sunday archives. And sometimes it changes. Sometimes I'll interview a pe person from Japan or something, and there's just no way to get them on it well at 12 o'clock. So
Yeah,
I'll throw in some stuff.
there's a movie, a book about Donald Pleasence, who was in so many movies, including Star Trek. And so they interviewed Neil. I have to have things that make me remember,
I
so. Yeah. But they interviewed me along with F. Murray Abraham and a bunch
Oh.
of other people. So I'm going to be in good company, I'll keep you abreast of what's going on. And I would love to just get together with you.
I would love that too. You never know, I haven't been to San Luis,
Just
but
a song or two. We can have some fun.
yeah, why not? I'm totally into it. And just for those of you who are in LA, Friday night I'm working in Pasadena at the 1881 with a great band, Otmar Ruiz, Joel Taylor, and Ahmet Sezen, which they are
Oh, fantastic. What
fantastic.
time?
8:30 to 11:30, some reasonable hours.
Pasadena, I like that. And what's the name of the place again?
The 1881. It's an
Okay.
old bar there.
Okay, 1881, everybody. And be there or be square, okay?
Thank you. And for those of you who are interested in who's coming on, just go on my site because it's always changing.
Yeah. You're gonna have a jazz. Is this smooth jazz or what are you doing? I don't get you for bebop. You know,
Modern jazz, not smooth is, nope. Modern though, it's kind of,
modern jazz.
it's edgy and, not kind of the old standard stuff. It's edgy. It's
That
pretty
sounds
cool.
pretty good.
Yeah.
All right. Well, and you have a calendar that's online too, don't you? Where
Absolutely.
you're all right. So you know what to do. And I'll be meeting you there, everybody. I'll let you know. Just check in.
See, Diane, I think you actually need a show of your own, actually.
Oh, hey, I'll end up talking about diets all day long. No, gaining the weight and how to lose it, and then how to eat and recipes, and then gain and lose it again. So whatever. But so thank you so much, Kathy, and thanks for putting up with my shenanigans today and letting me share my stories. And God bless you. I love you, and I look forward to seeing you real soon.
All right, thank you. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Hi, Daryl. Hey, Karen.